Very good. Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this closing panel. I'm Roberto Lenton. I'm a professor in biological systems engineering here at UNL, and enjoy the title of Distinguished Daugherty Fellow with the Water for Food Institute. And some of you may remember I was Peter's predecessor until last year. We have a wonderful panel here with us to close this conference. The bios of several of our panelists are in the folder that you have, so we won't go into great detail, but I want to simply introduce them and then ask them, when they make their own remarks, to describe or to identify 9 words that describe themselves. So you'll hear a little bit more from them in that way. But we have on the left Mike Boehm, who is the Harlan Vice Chancellor of the Institute of Agriculture and Natural Resources here at UNL, and also Vice President for Agriculture and Natural Resources of the University of Nebraska. We have Giovanni Piccinni, who is the Global Production Sustainability Lead from Monsanto Company in St. Louis, Missouri. We have Marcos Forigati, who is Professor of Biosystems Engineering in the University of Sao Paulo, Brazil. And last but not least, we have Margaret Catley-Carlson, who has many hats, former President of the Canadian International Development Agency and Chair of the Global Water Partnership, and currently the Vice Chair of the Canadian Water Network in Vancouver, Canada. So we have 4 panelists with very, very different backgrounds and perspectives about water issues in general, water for food issues specifically, and of course about this conference. And our opportunity in this global, in this closing panel, the opportunity that we have is really to take stock of the conference. And when I say we, it's the panelists and all of us in this room, really take stock of this conference and the theme, which is going from local lessons to global impacts. So to kick off this collective reflection of taking stock of the conference, I've asked the panelists, and the panelists have agreed to just have a few initial remarks on basically 2 things. The first is, what does this theme mean to them? What does the theme of local lessons to global impacts, what does it mean? How do they interpret that? And secondly, what have they learnt from the conference, from the various different proceedings from that they didn't know before on this question that relates local lessons to global impacts? So they are going to share with us up to 5 minutes each, and then we will have a more general reflection collectively. So be prepared to comment and to engage and to share your own reflections of this wonderful 3 days that we've had together. So without any further ado, if I could ask Mike Boehm, if you would start.
Absolutely. Thanks, Roberto. 9 words: collaborative, community, curious, engaged, family, blessed, phytopathology, veteran, and Huskers. There we go. Tough. So some personal reflections and then what I've learned. So personal reflections, one of the things that happened is I got to take a little trip down memory lane, maybe some nostalgic remembrances. I'm a plant pathologist, but I grew up in a suburb of Cleveland, Ohio. So the first thing that kind of came back to my mind is 1969 and the Cuyahoga River catching on fire. And why did that that neuron fire, it's because we had that conversation about point source pollution and our own journey on the understanding of the environment and water. Flash forward 25 years or 20 years or so, and my next reflection was a little back on my time as an undergraduate student at a small liberal arts college, where I happened to have the good fortune to work with a group in a water quality laboratory that studied non-point source pollution. And in particular, we heard a speaker, I think, talk about atrazine loading or pesticide loading, herbicide loading on sediment, and how that sediment started in tertiary streams and ultimately made it into large bodies of water. And I happened again to be growing up on Lake Erie. We heard about estuaries, and that brought back ideas and the importance of estuaries as the kidneys of the earth, and that brought me back to that summer I spent in a limnology laboratory flipping midge larvae over on their backs under a microscope and speciating them. And that's probably why I'm a plant pathologist, not a benthos person. But as far as learning, the neurons were definitely firing. I loved the notion of the blue revolution. I hadn't heard that phrase before. That was one of the tweets I put out there. My understanding of SDG 2 and SDG 6, to end hunger, achieve food security, and improve nutrition and promote sustainable agriculture. SDG 6, to ensure availability and sustainable management of water. Those were important lessons and thoughts. I love the fact somebody mentioned, and it made me think a lot about making sure we took a watershed approach. I think that was the quote. I loved very much yesterday at lunch the comments and the importance of empowering women in decision-making and reproductive rights, and that led me to think about Norman Borlaug, and I think Robert showed a picture of Norman Borlaug. And Norman definitely was a breeder, but Norman Borlaug was also a plant pathologist, in fact, the only plant pathologist ever to win the Nobel Prize. And that got me thinking about crop breeding and the Green Revolution. But the Green Revolution was also about population management, and it really also was about empowering women and reproductive rights. I thought a lot about Frank Zybach here, 1947, 1948, the person who pulled the first patent on center pivot irrigation. I thought about how in the 1960s, astronauts from 270 miles above the Earth were able to pick out Nebraska because of the green crop circles, and how Popular Mechanics that same year talked about center pivot irrigation as being perhaps the most important shift in agriculture since the turn of horse-drawn implements to mechanized agriculture. And that got me thinking about data and data analytics, and then listening to our producers on that last panel and what we saw from the cab of a tractor and the importance of data and how that moves in there. And then my last, I guess, thoughts were around how important STEM disciplines are. And many of us are in the science and technology disciplines, but we won't do this alone, and how important the humanities are. And we had the good fortune to have some very gifted photographers, and we had artists join us, and thinking about how we are all scientists and technologists and producers perhaps, but we're also cultural brokers, and how critically important these technical solutions have to survive within the context of humanity and the human condition, or else we will not be able to achieve what Jeff Rakes shared with us yesterday and the challenge he put out on the table. Don't forget David and Lucy. Don't settle for the status quo. So those were some reflections that I took away from our time together.
Well, thank you very much, Mike. That was a terrific start, and Really great to have your insights. And let me now ask Giovanni.
Thank you. Well, I guess probably given the name and the accent, you're probably going to figure out what the first word is that's going to describe me. That's Italy. On a more personal basis, kids. And then going to my career in water, irrigation, management. You can put it all together, all this world, if you want to. And most recently, seed, farming. And then the two words that really I like the most that probably better describe what I do today and how I'm involved in the arena of agriculture is global and sustainability. And I'd really like to comment on, first of all, what a great conference. This is the first time actually I'm attending, and a lot of take-home messages, right? And interestingly enough, as I was reflecting on my career in agriculture, I'm not going to get into the details of how many years ago, but a few years ago, as I was doing my PhD thesis, I was working on boiler conservation practices. And we were using instruments for remote sensing. We were using instruments that looked at canopy temperature. And, we're still using the same instruments. We're still using the same technology. It's been a few years, and we're still addressing the same issues, and we barely touched the tip of the iceberg. And it's interesting to me, you know, how much more do we need to do to really bring to that point of what this conference really means to me, what the topic of the conference means to me, is meet the demand for food of a growing population. We need to maintain, the ability to grow food, and to grow food, we need water. To grow crop, we need water. To have seed, we need water. How do we do that in a sustainable way? How do we do that in a way that can maintain from a private sector freedom to operate, while at the same time respecting the environment and providing the growing population with the food that is needed? Incredible work that has been done over the last few years, and I really appreciated the comments that I've heard today, especially during the opening session. Brian Rachter said something about chasing the water. It's interesting, I was part of a panel not too long ago on crop migration, right? So, and it was at NCAR in Colorado, and we were talking about, do we really need to continue to grow crops in those areas that are sensitive to drought, or we start implementing policies where we actually move crops from one area to another to optimize water resources? And without getting into any, specific example, that's something made you think about it. I mean, how do we position ourselves? How does the industry position itself also to meet the demand if we start thinking about water migration? Crop migration, sorry. The last thing I wanted to make a comment about is water conservation practices. I am amazed at the work that we've been doing over the last 10 years. Huge progress, the industry, irrigation industry, university, extension services, federal agencies at the global level have done a tremendous job in trying to optimize water resources and educating growers and users of water to better use those resources and so that they can actually be more efficient and more profitable. We were talking, yes, but at the same time, I've heard about lawyers talking about market of water rights, and it's a big topic. And so, water is a commodity, right? You can trade it today, and you can make money. So ultimately, we need to think about it that for some farmers, maximum yield, it's not necessarily maximum profit. So, optimizing profit is what the growers today is about, and that always come with proper use of water resources. Maybe one or two less irrigation when the cost of pumping water and the cost of running a pivot is high, can lead to a much higher profit. And as I was listening to some of the folks that were involved in water conservation and in water markets and the lawyers, there are a lot of local problems that need to be solved. We don't have a global policy for water rights. And that's what I think, I'd like to see us moving forward in the future. At the same time, how do we better educate our growers, how are the users in the use of resources. And I like to bring an example, and I'm going to close very quickly. I work in a, I have a global role, so I had to deal with the production across several different countries. And Some countries, and the conversation with growers about water conservation often is easier in those countries, in those areas where they are more prone to drought and extreme drought, and they're very, they really like to implement technology for water conservation. I always think bring the example of my son that comes back from college, and he drives my car all the time without any problem because I'm the one filling up the tank. And then this year I implemented a conservation practices by saying, from this point forward, you will be paying for gas. Needless to say, he put half of the miles on that car that he would have put otherwise. So do we really get to a point where the cost of water is so high that we are forced to implement water technology and water conservation practices? I don't know, something to think about. Thanks.
Very good. Well, thanks, Giovanni. That was a great reflection, and the power of incentives, as you say. Marcos is next, Marcos Foligati.
Okay. Agronomist, persistent, positive, bike rider, waters and society, bird watcher, irrigation, conservation, and grandchildren. This is my fourth time on the Water for Food Conference. And the first event I attended was 2010, and already showed me the enormous potential on the Water for Food Institute to discuss the importance, complexity, and the need for the correct use of water in agriculture. There has since been a tremendous breakthrough in the topics discussed, as well the depth of the process. In the Water for Food Conference 2017, I would like to highlight the following matters. The International Advisory Board, we met last Sunday to previously discuss many of the topics covered in this conference. And at the beginning, I did not imagine the high depth that the proposed topics would be debated. I particularly got quite divided on the themes simultaneously sections that would like to watch, to attend, ask and learn, and I end up watching a little bit of everything. Let me highlight a few points again. When on a section one, the first day, we had then a section on Nebraska cover crop, experience demonstrate the importance and the benefits of nutrient recycling and addition of dry matter. But in the meanwhile, the greater use of water. And then I think no tillage is a reality in tropical countries. So I think it's something we need to consider. On the other section, water frontier section, water markets, I'd like to thank Nick and Chris Hartley for bringing this important topic into discussion. And why not say understanding? I particularly need a little more time to understand the Texas system. Although it has been didactically explained by John Tracy. The state of Alabama's water management system is quite peculiar, given the privilege of using water from properties that are in riparian areas, and even with the high precipitation that occurs in that state, the irrigation in short periods of deficit can be financially viable. In Brazil, we have a complete different system. We have watershed committees. You have to have a permit to use water. So water market is something that I'm learning about, but we need to work more on that. The Australian water market system presented by Colin Sartre showed us that they were able to separate land and water and have transparent system, but the flow does not reach the sea. That brings the environment flows that is a big issue in many places. How are we going to deal with this environment flow issue that should be considered in order to keep flowing in the water? And some words were very striking to me. Data is old, incomplete, and inaccessible. Why do the system do not collapse? We're probably having more water than we think we're measuring. That's something that keeps bothering me. I think we still have a lot of difficulty in giving value to guarantee the process of infiltration of water in the soil, or the reduction of erosion process, carbon fixation. I mean, environment service, service providers, and service users. We need to keep that in mind. Water governance and water management of great rivers. We had a presentation about Ganges River. And they had a lot of problem with information. The information is there, but it's not available. They're using some remote sensing to do some interesting studies. What a huge local lesson. I was amazed with the water management in Missouri River. That's another huge local global lesson presented by Robert Jacobson. I just want to finish talking about water quality. I think we need to do a lot, keep doing a lot of presentation on that. And I often ask my students if they would eat vegetables irrigated with sewage water. And they answer me suspiciously that they would not, but they are eating. So we, in many countries, we still need to do a lot of things on management. Like my country, it's the 9th economy of the world. We have a centipedes, big farmers like we just saw here, but we still have a lot of small holders that we need to take care of. That's something we need also to keep looking very carefully. That's my first thoughts.
Well, thank you very much, Marcos. And you know, your comments reinforce what I think is the experience of so many people around the room, which is when they are here in the sessions, listening to the experiences in Australia or some other part of the world, they're always connecting it to their own context, in your case, Brazil. And I'm sure that's what really makes the conference meaningful. People listen, and then they interpret and think about what it means in their own context. Let me turn it over to Maggie now, Maggie Catley-Carlson. I should mention that both Marcos and Maggie are distinguished members of the International Advisory Panel of the Water for Food Institute, and from importantly have that additional perspective, which is so useful. So thank you again.
Thank you. 9 words. Canadian, bureaucrat, diplomat, policy, manager, boards, constant traveler, good cook, therefore plump like Mr. Kessel's seeds, interested in all water aspects. That's all one word. Okay, so that's my 9. We were asked to look at 2 issues. First of all, has the conference succeeded? Are there local lessons that you can actually take and make them global? I have a very firm view on this. Yes and no. So now that you know what the bottom line is, yes and no, I'll tell you. Let's take some examples from the conference. We had great sessions on water markets, and you know, Tracy, Christie, and Chart really just did a marvelous job of case studies to enlighten us. And water markets are a great, very useful tool, but there's no prescriptions. The conditions have to be right. There's pretty good agreement on about 5 basic foundation needs before you could start to even imagine having water markets. And so maybe that's what goes global. It isn't the examples, it isn't the model, it isn't the cooked business plan, it's the foundation needs and the major elements that characterize good and successful water markets. Another example, yes, cover crops, useful economically, environmentally positive, even kind of pretty. But no, certain soils and economic conditions, and it's too expensive, and it really doesn't add value under certain conditions. So a good list of evaluative mechanisms, but you can't leave the conference saying everybody needs cover crops. unless you're prepared to look at the economics of those cover crops, if you really, really want them, and who might actually provide the subsidy to make cover crops possible. So no to the, do we have a universal prescription? Yes to the fact that we know enough now to make really good decisions on that. Yes, there are excellent new techniques, technologies, information, advantages for irrigation for the small farmer. But in the poorest populations, everywhere, real change depends on some level of empowerment for those whose behavior needs to change. And another but, there's no universal formula to improve small farmer efficiency in irrigation. And Mwamba Kamba said, you know, you have to make sure local farmers have the ability, the agency to identify problems, assess the options, and make their own focused demands and reviews on government. Now, what kind of hydrology school or engineering school teaches those things? So yes, on one side, but really a long way to go, because we spend a lot of resources at one end of the spectrum and not very many resources at the other end. And another end, the World Bank tells us that small-scale irrigation is blocked by institutional deficiencies, infrastructure, and market access conflict resolution. That isn't also what they teach in hydrology or in water schools. So if we want to solve the problem, we've got to have different instruments to look at what we're told by experts really are the issues here. So, lessons to take home. I got six of them. They get shorter. First, great new interest, great people, new players, wonderful to see young, knowledgeable people, knowledgeable about everything from viruses and algae to power enhancement of women in Bangladesh to management for huge rivers. The professionalization in these fields is really extraordinary. So that's my first lesson to take home. The skills are increasingly there, and where they're not, they're being developed, and people are writing down what the deficiencies are and going out and studying them. Second one, knowledge is growing incrementally, but the impact of that knowledge on people we want to reach is not necessarily growing incrementally. And that was brought up by so many people saying they'd produced the knowledge, but they really could not, in all honesty, find a trace of that in the populations that they'd have managed could use that. Governments and universities and all of us should be taking more seriously the fact that this is about resource allocation. And if you're truly trying to solve a problem, as opposed to having the enjoyment of inventing a new irrigation system, then you've got to bring the resources to bear that correspond to the problems that are stopping the real implementation of what it is that you're doing. We still use the model of building solutions and then try and sell these to farmers and authorities. Much more comfortable developing new technology, building data sets, etc., and creating prescriptions than figuring out how to actually get these to the farmer. In other words, starting at the farmer. So that's the second one. That's a real take-home message. Third take-home message. Case studies are amazing. They really are the best way to communicate, I think, to all of us about what's happened. And I guess this is a message to our own organization. Where we had case studies that were replete with the political environment, the economic environment, the skills that were needed, we really got a very good picture of what is actually needed. I won't recite the places where this happened, but I would recommend a heavy emphasis on case studies for the next conferences. And I'm very glad to hear that Water for Food is working with EDF to create more case studies, and I hope we'll have a lot of those next year, because I think it forces people to actually look at a 360-degree environment that this takes place. Fourth thing. Not enough data? I'm not sure. You've got people drowning in data. And again, you go back to what's really needed. Fifth, my take-home message, it's okay to pronounce the words climate change in the United States. Coming down from Canada, I was really wondering whether there would be a climate change police at the door saying, are you going to pronounce those words? Not only do we pronounce it, we discussed it very intelligently, and I discovered that people are still discussing the issues intelligently and courageously. So that's a very good thing. As I say, we in the North watching you have questions. I'm sure just like the questions you have yourself, but we're glad to know you still can pronounce the word and talk about it. So that's number five. Number six, cocktail chatter. You always need to take something home from a conference that you can use to wow people at a cocktail party. Alabama has 1 billion chickens. How is there any room for anybody to stand up? I really don't know. And there's 300,000 beetle varieties. Imagine that. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Maggie. I think that applause suggested that your comments and reflections resonated with the group. So, thanks for those comments. And before we have a general reflection, does anybody want to take issue with anything that anybody else said around the table? Good. Well, I take it that the time has come to open it up. We've had some very interesting issues that and reflections that people have had, but I'm sure in this larger group there are people who might take issue with some of what they heard. So let's see if there's anyone brave enough to take the first step, as it were. And I think there are mics in the middle of the room for those of you who want to be brave. There we are, John.
I just have a question, or sort of, I'm curious. Jeff Rakes, when he started the conference, he talked about living in a time of interesting challenges, and he talked about the critical nature of this whole issue we're working on, water and food security. I work in USAID on the Middle East and North Africa, where water is a challenge. But I wonder, you know, what your perspectives are, and if you agreed with him that this is one of the most urgent challenges of all the challenges before us. We have a number of challenges in my region, and you know, the region I work in and others. Do you agree that water and food security really do deserve the attention that some of us think it should get? And how would we make that argument more effectively? I'd appreciate your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I'll jump in. I absolutely concur with Jeff, and I thought his addition to Hank Bounds' comments, where Hank was saying it was the most critical, even with nuclear proliferation, so forth and so on. I think it's absolutely critical, and I didn't share this. It was kind of a half-empty view, and that was as we learned about the pernicious cycle that drought leads to lack of accessible food, nutritious food, that leads to poverty, that leads to this stunting that just keeps going over and over. And today, I think, we have 1 billion people in abject poverty around the globe. In Nebraska, we have 13.4% of Nebraskans don't know where their next meal's coming from. And that's a complex issue, not just related to water. I think the national average in the U.S. is 14.6%. But it does blow my mind, as one of the newest Nebraskans, how a state that produces so much food in abundance, and Leon was right, it's about getting that food to people. But how do we have food insecurity? How do we have 100,000 kids that don't know where their meal's coming from? I think that this is there. So my glass half empty view was I conjured up this notion of the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And when you think about food security, when you think about water security, absolutely, you start getting into conquest, you start getting into war, you get into famine, and you get to death. And I think the underpinnings of basic human needs, if they're not met, lead to destabilization around the globe, and we'd better be paying attention to it. No question about it.
Thanks, Mike. I think, Maggie, you wanted to jump in?
Yeah, on the Middle East, it's one of my but and response, because piling up more statistics and more facts on how better management of water in the Middle East or better management of energy or collaboration doesn't do the trick in changing the perceptions that exist. This does not mean that I know what does the trick, but if, for example, you put up a huge solar energy grid in North Africa and you started collecting solar energy and making water, making desalinated water from that, you could supply a good deal of Europe's foreseen energy needs. But if you started in Morocco, you've got to go through Algeria. And Algeria won't let anything go through Algeria. And Morocco and Algeria can't even talk about it because of a little territory that's been in contention for 20 years. So how do you make the benefits sufficiently attractive, particularly with a leadership that hasn't changed for about as long, to actually provoke change? Because the recitation of the information and facts about the possible benefits don't do the trick. When you go to the Mashrak, to the area bounding Egypt, there is so much information that water is not being used in a way that's optimal to meet the real needs of an awful lot of Egyptians, of Saudi Arabians, of et cetera, et cetera. But these are countries that have huge political instabilities, and removing water from any of the rural populations is simply going to increase that destabilization. And we've seen what happens with the destabilization in the Arab Springs and the very unhappy sequels to the Arab Spring in virtually all countries, possible exception Tunisia. So knowing that it could be better from a water viewpoint is not the first step in actually getting there, because one can come up with the ideas, the concepts, all the rest of it. If Algeria is not talking to its neighbors, you can't build an electrical grid, no matter how attractive it becomes in terms of exports, etc. By the way, I don't think it's our job to feed the world. I think it's the world's job to feed the world, and that countries wish to feed, for the largest part, their own populations. We should certainly be, as food exporters, Canada is too, very willing to supply the marginal edge, but our job is really to help the world feed the world and then also be willing to export. We're all exporters and we're all importers.
Thanks, Maggie. I'm not sure if anybody else wants to come in on you, both of you. Very good. So let me start with, I guess, Giovanni, you got the mic closer to you.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to respond in a more practical way. The answer to your question is yes, right? To me, water is the most important factor. I said that in my opening comments. We need to meet the food demand of a growing population. And we do have a responsibility, Maggie, to meet that demand. From an industry perspective, we need to meet the demand for food. And water is going to be key to meet that. But at the same time, I'm very happy to see how the private sector, together with the public sector, is working together to really work towards water conservation practices. We have an opportunity to influence how growers use their water resources in order to produce food. And we have an opportunity, let me give you an example based on what we were doing at Monsanto. You know, we made a commitment to the World Business Council for Sustainable Development that we will increase our water application efficiency by 25% by the year 2020. This is a true commitment. This is global. This is going to make an impact on a daily basis in the way the growers use their water resources, the way the growers manage their water resources on a daily basis. With that, we feel like we also have an opportunity to educate growers, because we really have a global impact. And so that's a tremendous opportunity that doesn't happen every day. The ability to talk to that farmer and providing him with the tools necessary to manage water resources. I mean, and this is more impactful to me than waiting for a legislative initiative that might take years before it can come to place.
Marcos.
Yes, I'd like to also to say yes to, I agree. I'd like to answer that question relating to the presentation we had this morning by Chandra, that is irrigation and the value chain development. I think we need to pay more attention in every step when we are producing, to look at the whole system. Preparing the soil, choosing the seed, killing the bugs, irrigating without water, No, we're not going to produce harvesting, storage, commercializing. So we just had here one farmer, one big farmer from Brazil telling us all the problem he has to produce, he has to fix the road, he has to to hire people for security. Can you imagine smallholders? If we don't help them to organize the whole system? So for sure, water and food security, but a lot of things in the middle that we cannot forget to put together.
Well, thanks, Marcos, and thanks to the four of you for your responses to a great question. Let me see if there's some other reflections. There we have one. Please.
I suppose I have a bit of a comment and a bit of a question.
Could you identify yourself first?
My name is Chris Hartley. I'm with USDA's Office of Environmental Markets. I've greatly enjoyed what Water for Food enabled us to do here at this conference. I think we probably had the most complete discussion of water quantity markets that I've seen, period. That's a great start. Also, having been here for the past few days, I really regret that I have not been able to see more of the conference and look forward to being able to see it online when it's posted. I guess my question to all of you is, how do we take that information, how do we take that growth in understanding and knowledge and put it both into our policies and our practices moving forward? As someone who works in a government agency, there's an awful lot of us. And yet, I think what it is that you have to say probably has as much or a greater impact than what we say and what we hear. So how can you help us make those policies work for you?
Well, thanks very much for that great question. It's really the kind of question that most of us have given some thought to, so I'm not sure who would like to get the ball rolling, as it were. It looks as though Maggie will jump into the fray.
I would turn that question around and say, how should we, to you? You know, I was in government for very many years, 30 years. Looking back on it, I'm constantly uncomfortable about how little we were nourished by the views and the wisdom of conferences like this. I think that good things have happened in the past few years of opening them up, of making sure that people attend conferences and workshops. But I think the way that you change government's mind is like the old adage, you know, I am the leader, these are my people, I must follow them. Because government and governance change with popular opinion for better or for worse, sometimes for better, sometimes for worse. And I think that we really have to spend a lot of the energy trying to do things that will influence the way that these issues are talked about publicly. You know, clearly you can send messages, aide memoir, letters, demands, all the rest of it, but they get filed. You know, but governments are big and complex places, nowhere more than USDA. But, you know, I'd like you to tell us on the basis of what you've seen of USDA and how it makes policy change, how it is that best that the kinds of ideas from this kind of conference actually percolate into USDA understanding. Sure, it certainly has. You can see in Feed the Future and in some very enlightened programs that ideas like these have certainly made it into the policy formulation.
Thanks, Maggie. I see others wanting to come in on that. Marcos, are you itching to go?
I'd like just to tell my experience. And I volunteer in my country to be part of the watershed committee. And I was 5 years ago in a position to talk with the farmers. Our system, and we charge the industry, we charge the water treatment to pay for the water. We try to the farmers also to take the water from the river or from the aquifer. But took about 20 years to get there. So I think each one of us in each place, they are going to need to find their own way to solve this kind of problem. But that was a very important for me from being an academic at university and get together with the people from industry, the people from water treatment, and from the farmers, and looking at all the sides they're looking at, the different interests, the better way to find the right price to charge. So, you know, water pricing can be, we can have a very nice models, right? But dealing with farmers, you can imagine how long that talk could take, right? So, but we end up finding one way. So in our place, just discussing, so we found one way that the farmers in our watershed that's responsible, the Piracicaba River in São Paulo is responsible for 7% of our GPD in a 15,000 square kilometer watershed. And when that found that one way to charge the right amount for them, and all the money that's been collected has been applied to the water management system. I think there are many ways to do that. So in each place we are finding some local lessons that we need to keep doing, sharing this information the way we solve in each place. I think there is no such answer which way we have to do it. We need to find our own.
Thanks, Marcos. I see Mike and Giovanni. So we go with Giovanni and then Mike.
Yeah, sure. Appreciate the question. And I really want to bring it back to actually to your presentation yesterday. I enjoy your work that you're doing on the data collection. And I'm thinking about, a few years ago, I think we're going the right direction. I think we're creating the right tool that is going to help us to make informed decisions. And, a few years ago, we had a lot of anecdotal information about climate change, a lot of water depletion and everything else. Today we are inundated with, for lack of better words, with data of localized study and everything else. Having a system that allows us to have a centralized way to collect it, to have all this information, like something similar to what you presented yesterday, where you were saying, why wouldn't you not want to use this system? Why don't you want to see the results of this study? Why don't you use the system to help making decisions? That's what we need. We need a place, one place where we can go, get all the information we need at a global level, and make informed decisions with our legislators and government agencies and so on and so forth.
A couple of thoughts. I think we're on the right track, and I think conferences like this that bring diverse perspectives and different understandings of the world together are really critical. One of the things we can do is distill some of what we're talking about, and that's what this session's about right now, kind of what are those big nuggets of wisdom that we might be able to take away. I think I always say it all the time, think globally and act locally. So this was a little play on that frame. I think it's really important that at the local level, so, in Nebraska or the Institute of Ag and Natural Resources, that we have a team that's committed to a common shared vision. That doesn't mean lockstep, but we have to be clear about where we're going. And a blessing, I think, in no question that brought me here to Nebraska are the partnerships that exist between our producers, our farmers, our ranchers, our state government, our NRDs. We have a really amazing system, and it's a small enough population that people are about 1 degree to 2 degrees of freedom separated from each other. And so you can get the right people with the right diversity of ideas in a room, but then we have to drop a little bit of our parochialism when we go to Washington, D.C. Chuck Hibbard and Archie Clutter and myself and three producer growers from Nebraska were making hill visits, and we were with all the other land-grant universities. For the first time ever, the land-grant universities in the U.S. that have ag programs decided to have a unified ask of their congressional delegation, which was to increase funding for the programs that stimulate work in agriculture, natural resources, and community development. So if we're all going in, if horticulturalists are going in separate from plant pathologists or entomologists or beef systems people, and Company X is going in and saying something other than Company Y, we're our own worst enemy. So somewhere through the unified perspective and shared vision, we have to congeal a story, a narrative that we can take forward. And really, it's a simple principle. United we stand and divided we fall. So it's my two cents.
Well, thanks, Mike, and thanks to all four of you. And thanks for that great question that stimulated these responses. My own two bits is that I feel in all these conferences that very often it's just a multiplicity of very small steps that occurs as a result of people gaining insights, changes in perspective that then get translated into changes in behavior over time that then get translated into things happening and policies getting evolving. So that a lot of that what happens really happens through all of us in this room and beyond. I do need to leave some time for Peter to close the conference, so unfortunately we can't take any more questions from the floor, but let me ask if the panelists have any half-minute reflections before turning it over to Peter. Maggie, do you want to start? We'll go that way.
Sure. It's just a repetition of what I said earlier. If we're serious about certain problems, we've got to look at what the common wisdom truly is about what the impediments are to solving those problems, and to see if we're putting the resources in at the right place and we've got the right resources to actually go after the kind of social change that may be antecedent to the kind of technical improvements and productivity improvements that we'd all really like to see.
Marcos?
Well, I think we are in the right direction. And just a few points we need to pay attention. And like we mentioned before, what are we going to do the package for smallholders? What are we going to do the package for big farmers and things like that? So I need to look in a different way from both cases.
Thanks, Marcos. Thank you. Giovanni.
Yeah, to me, it's what I said earlier. You know, to me, being in the conference today and seeing that we're still talking and addressing issues that were there and that were very relevant 20 years ago, it's a little bit disarming. But at the same time, seeing the all of us coming together in a forum such as this one or other forums that address water issues is really encouraging. And I think these are the platforms that are really going to help us to springboard us to the next level of education and water conservation practices. And my ask to everybody, to any person that works in this arena, is to be vocal. And really, we need to make sure that we spread the message and we really do a better job at educating all the folks that are involved in water.
And I'll just I'll go back to the Will Rogers quote that we heard yesterday, right? Even if you're on the right track, if you're not moving, you're going to get run over. So I would just say to all of us, I absolutely believe we are on the right track on a number of fronts. Watch out for the trains and keep moving.
Thanks, Mike. And like you and Giovanni and others, I feel really very encouraged by the last two or three days. Just the energy, the vitality, the knowledge in the room was really fantastic. What I think was maybe the most encouraging is just the number of young people who were up doing, saying interesting things. I was really blown away by the session yesterday with the students from the Rakes Design School and how they're innovating in ways that are really, really useful for producers and researchers and agency people alike. And then today with the poster sessions and the photography and so on, again, examples of how young people are really interested and engaged in this subject and carrying it forward. And that's in the end a big, big part of our mission. So I feel very, very encouraged and feel very grateful to be able to be a part of it. Last but not least, I think we have to invite Peter to the podium, but before doing so, thank our panel. If you could all join me.
Thank you, Roberto. Thank you, distinguished panel. That was very, I think you've done my job for me in many ways, so I'm very pleased for those inputs. I'd just like to thank you all for being here. I think this is, and many of you have come many distances, some more tortuous than you expected, but certainly, I'm thinking of you, Rob, in fact, that it's certainly been a challenging week for some. I'm just to echo Roberto's point, the enthusiastic participation. I think that's, the words don't really fit what we've witnessed over the last two or three days, but we've had some fantastic sessions, some keynotes that stimulated all kinds of discussions and provoked and certainly further added fuel to the discussions. The photographs that we saw at lunchtime, all fueled by lots of coffee, great food, and fabulous music that we've had at all the sessions. The sessions, again, as many of people have been saying, they couldn't be at all of the sessions. All of this has been live streamed. It's on the web or coming onto the web, so certainly opportunities to go back and reflect on these things. The groundwater governance session, I managed to sit through some of that this morning. We've heard a lot about the water market session, a lot of enthusiasm about what progress made there. The health sessions, I think Alan Kolok's presentation yesterday also stimulated a lot of thought and got people thinking about water quality more, shall we say, constructively and thinking about some of the challenges ahead. We had a very good session on irrigation in sub-Saharan Africa yesterday. Water productivity, climate change, Maggie. We had a good session on climate change this morning that, again, I think moved things forward. We had a lot about citizen science and the value of citizen science. And again, farmers being centric to many of the discussions. I think that's hugely important in the context of this conversation. Crop phenotyping, I see a Twitter feed this morning about how we've managed to link the Water for Food Institute to crop breeding and crop phenotyping, and that's certainly something we need to be doing more of and looking for the opportunities there. Have we moved the needle in these sessions? We started off, we want to have outcomes. We want to see how we can progress towards impact. Can we move the research and the knowledge we have towards impact? I think that needs to be reflected on, but I think there's important next steps. We tried to tease that out in some of the sessions. I think there's more to do. People are going away with some homework around that. And one of the thoughts, we're not planning on a conference next year. We're leading into the World Water Congress in Brasilia. So the idea is this conference feeds into that and many of the ideas that have evolved. But in before that, what are the other things we can be doing? And one thing we've been talking to many of our partners about is having a more focused version of this sort of emphasis on heading towards outcomes, these key areas that we see important to take forward, having it in Washington, D.C. or elsewhere, where perhaps one thing we haven't got at this conference yet is getting the decision makers into the room around some of these points. But that's certainly something we are talking to a number of the partners in this room. I think certainly we're going away with new resolve. There's some ideas about solutions. I think what Mike was saying there about the story, getting the story to the right people, I think is important, because I think one of the things I see is the water, food, political recognition of this challenge has really risen. There's a political understanding of what's going on and people understanding. The issue is it's so complicated now that it's difficult to get the right message through that into that situation. How can we have impact? So that certainly we need to take that, the sort of more measured, the bold stories that we all kind of can agree on and understand what we need to get through to the decision makers. I want to reflect, it takes a village, and in many ways it takes a village to get to where we are in the Water for Food in the Institute, but in particularly with the conference. It's taken the university, and I mean the university very broadly. This is our the Water for Food Institute is really across the university system, and it's taken a lot of people from the university helping to put this on, and the different people who have participated, the City of Lincoln, the many players in the state of Nebraska. It is like a small village in terms of how people really focus around this issue, and all of you. I think that's really adds to what we've been able to achieve in the last couple of days. And again, those of all of you who made the effort to be here. I would like to thank the Robert B. Daugherty Foundation and the University of Nebraska, the Nebraska Corn Board and Lycor Biosciences, Syngenta, Synager Irrigation, and Monsanto are sponsors. We have significant investments. It takes significant investments to put on a conference like this, and the effort around managing it, supporting it, putting on the conference, but also the funding to ensure we can achieve this. We've met our board of directors, Jeff Rakes, our departing board chair and co-founder of the Rakes Foundation. I think, again, his speech yesterday is very relevant to what we're trying to do, and sort of he, as a water for food champion, he certainly has contributed greatly in that area. Hank Bounds, the president of the University of Nebraska, Moens By, the chairman of the Robert B. Daugherty Foundation, and J.B. Milligan, Chancellor of the City University of New York and past president of the University of Nebraska. I also would like to thank the other leadership here at the university, particularly Chancellor Ronnie Green, who was present in a number of our events, Mike Boehm, who you've just heard from, Ron Yoder, and I think Ron was mentioning earlier about him being part of the old guard that set up this institute, and certainly there's others in the room. Monica Norby, I think, is still here. Tom Farrell has already headed back home, but certainly these are people who have been did the heavy lifting in some of the earlier conferences, people I met when I first came here in 2009 for the initial conference. I would like to also mention at this point that I was remiss on the first day to also mention Prem Paul, who passed away this year. Prem Paul, to me, was the face of the Institute prior to Roberto coming on board, and certainly around the world, he had tremendous energy, and unfortunately, we lost him late last year. We've heard from a number of the international advisory panel, and I think you can see from Maggie and Marcus just how much they raise the bar and make a stretch and push to do more. Colin Chartres from Australia is here. Bashir Jama has already left, but he's with the Islamic Development Bank and a major supporter of our work. Uma Leila has been very active in the conference and contributing in many ways. Martin Passman from Argentina is sitting up here, who's also been very helpful. Peter Rogers was actually on our international advisory panel. Many of you will know him from Harvard. He, unfortunately, for health reasons, has stepped down this year, so someone that's contributed a lot. And Pasquale Steduto from FAO, who couldn't be with us this week. I apologize for going through a few lists here, but I think it's important to stress just who has contributed where in the conference. In planning this conference and really developing these sessions and thinking through how we can best push towards some outcomes to really translate where we see the areas that we should be contributing. The faculty fellows have played a very important role. Many have participated, many made presentations, particularly on session development and setting up the conference. There's Tala Awada, Roger Elmore, Corey Forbes, Trenton France, Alan Collock, who we saw yesterday stepping into to the gap, Peter Longo, Patrice Mahon, Bob Oglesby, Clint Rowe, and Nancy Shank. Again, that's the large team. We have a relatively small team within the Institute who have really set up this conference and been working diligently away in many aspects of it. Christopher Neal, our Research Development Director, Nick Brosovich, Chittaranjan Ray, Rachel Herpel, Craig Etting, Kate Gibson, Dana Ludwig, Amber Poitras, who was talking at lunch, Morgan Spies, and Jesse Starita, who you also heard at lunch. Last but not least, I want to mention Molly Nance, our communications director, who really, in terms of the coordination and setting up the conference, many people have contributed, but Molly, are you in the room? Hi, Molly. Thank you very much. It's a fabulous job. And perhaps just bear with me, can the team from the Water for Food Institute just stand up for a moment? Because I think all of you have done a fantastic job this week. There's Jesse, any of the Chittaranjan. Rachel's there. Rachel's hiding. So the rest, I'm not sure where they are. They're probably still discussing and talking. And yes, Dana up here on the communications. Great. Thank you very much, folks. We have also a number of students and interns who have helped. If you watch the movie on Monday night, we had Madeline Cass, Diana Lilly, Destina Petit, Harrison Rood, Haley Wilkie. I'm sure I've missed out many, but they've had a fantastic contribution to this conference with the many deep and rich aspects of the conference. We have had a fabulous Master of Ceremonies, Pat Morgan. I think, is Pat still here? Pat Morgan, thank you, Pat, one of our key sponsors as well, but Pat is always the face of our conference in many ways. And he has been introducing the speakers, helping the conference run smoothly. Photography, Brett Hampton on the photography and our video crew from Inspire Media and the UNL INR media team. I saw them also tweeting out and certainly providing all kinds of input. Allows us to put this information onto the web and have a much broader reach than just the 400 or so people who can be at this conference. I would like to thank the Lincoln Convention and Visitors Bureau and the volunteers who helped to pitch in on this event. It really has been, for me, a very constructive 2 or 3 days. I've learned a lot. Walking around, one of the things that's really interesting is to see these different folks from different parts of the world, from the Secretary of Irrigation from Tanzania, sitting at tables talking to someone from Nebraska about some of the challenges. And I won't call out all the different names, but I've seen people talking. It's great to see these connections. And I hope that's what you take forward and can report back at the next conference about what we actually achieved. So I think hopefully we've incubated that process. We reconvene here at 4:30, so I won't hold you much longer. We've got a relatively short break for the Herman lecture. And I think perhaps one of the major events of the conference now is with A.G. Kawamara, who is here, who's been participating and has been listening to what we've been saying, and we'll present the lecture in here. But please join us after that in the banquet hall. We still have got more food, and this time we're having an African theme with the African culture connection, and they will share the complexity of African culture with some through teaching, dancing, and drumming, and visual arts. So we expect you all to do some of help with the drumming. We had some really good drumming at lunchtime. So please participate in that. With that, again, I would like to thank you very much, and I would like to bring to close the 2017 Water for Food Global Conference. And this time, I've remembered my gavel.